morning, everyone. Good morning to everyone who is watching us, and of course, the people who are here with us today. This is the Delft Economic Forum, and it is one of the most prestigious and well-documented, well-represented by so many people from around the globe, and of course, the local, of course, governance and people who really take stand in what we want to create, the new Greece, Greece of development and growth. Of course, with us today is an amazing crowd of people who will be trying to delve into what is a matter of crucial importance, discussing what is the future, of course, of not just the European Union, but it is a global challenge, especially for the future generations. So we have so many things to talk about. Unfortunately, little time. Sorry for my view. And I will need to moderate for the first time. It's a change of roles. And today we're doing something new, as John Cleese said. We're going to try something completely different today. I'm usually, as a deputy minister for tourism, former deputy minister for education, used to reply to questions. So today I will be posing them. let me just share a little bit of the Greek perspective in what we call the reskilling and upskilling of the talent pool, especially in tourism education. And I would like to start by thanking, of course, the European Commission, because you have been instrumental in helping us in reshaping tourism education. We have been working together for almost 3 years in order to deliver what will be a new legislative initiative in the new government, and I'm sure that the new government will embrace it, of course. We have elections coming up in May. We call it the new Tourism Academy. It is a very important step for us, and it is a very important feature in order to fully deploy all the talent pool we have of young people who want to work in hospitality. And of course, I would also like to thank the European RRF, the Recovery and Resilience Fund, because more than 20,000 people will be taking part in a massive reskilling and upskilling, the largest ever reskilling and upskilling program that we will fully deploy starting mid-2023. We will work on new themes, on new topics, and deliver on a three-month seminar directed at people all around Greece. So again, thank you for being here. And of course, in my capacity as the moderator, I would also like to make some initial comments. Sorry for looking at my notes, but this really flu is really getting me down. So for the first time ever, I will be looking at my notes. So we know that the labor market is currently in the phase of cyclical recovery and, of course, undergoing structural transformation due to globalization. We see that everywhere, demographic factors and geopolitical challenges, advancing digital technologies, automation, and, of course, the changes due to the green transition. Against this background, businesses, enterprises increasingly report that the limited availability of skills poses an impediment, and I would also add a significant threat to this corporate investment. Genuine skill constraints can negatively affect the labor productivity, of course, and hamper the ability to innovate and adopt technological developments. Alongside technical skills, to succeed in the 21st century, currently, of course, the labor market, one needs a comprehensive, and I repeat, a comprehensive set of skills, including comprehensive knowledge, skills, and competences, often referred as core skills, basic skills, or soft skills. In this context, the European Year of Skills 2023, I think we should keep repeating that. Not enough people know that this is the Year of Skills 2023. It will be officially launched on May 9, put skills center stage, as we are today. On the other hand, Europeans need to have access to quality education and training and be equipped with the right skills in order to be able to respond to the above-mentioned changes and challenges and get quality and, I would also add, well-paid jobs. On the other hand, companies in the EU, in particular small and medium enterprises, like here in Greece, which is the core, of course, of the business profile, should support and be supported in addressing skill shortages in the EU. Ultimately, a skilled workforce can be a key driver in the sustainable growth, leading to more innovation and enhancing competitiveness of the European economy. The speakers of the panel who are here with us today will touch upon the following issues. The skills mismatch. It's a very current discussion we have between the skills provided through education and training and the skills demanded in the labor market. Developing, of course, and improving methods and jobs and tools, of course, to better anticipate labor market requirements and changes and achieve a better alignment of skill supply and demand. The importance, of course, it is the most important tool that we have, the financing methods and implementing reforms to prepare Europeans for a green and digital transition, but also improve inclusiveness and quality of education and training systems. Designing policies and addressing labor shortages and harnessing this talent pool both within and outside the EU. So, without further ado, on to our speakers. Here with us is Mario Nava. Hello, Mario.
Good morning.
He's the Director General for Structural Reform Support, the European Commission. And I again would like to thank you for all the support rendered to the Greek side. We have, of course, Isabel Beber, who's the Director and the Head of the International and European Affairs of BPI France. Welcome to Delphi. Javier Matteau, who is the Director at Interim and Head of Knowledge Hub at the European Training Foundation. Javier, let's have a discussion afterwards and a possible cooperation also with ATF alone concerning the tourism. And Emily Sino, who is the Head of Policy and Strategy Division in the Economics Department of the European Investment Bank, the EIB. The first question is for Mario, Mr. Mario Nava. First of all, I thank the DG reform. And now my question is about the types of reforms that are needed to ensure that the EU has a skilled workforce. And of course, what can you do? What can the EU, and in particular the DG reform, can help? How can you help in that direction? We have about 3.5 minutes, almost 4 minutes, if I am very, let's say, generous with the time.
Okay, thank you very much, Sophia, and thank you very much, everybody, for being here. I mean, the interesting thing is that a few years ago, we would have had on labor market a completely different debate, right? Because a few years ago, we were in a situation where there was abundance of workforce. Then two things arrived and changed dramatically. One is demography, of course, on the supply side. And the other is new jobs, artificial intelligence, and the change in nature of the job, which made that the few people we have, because the demography is what it is, and we are losing active people every year, but the few people we have need to be skilled. And I think your question is very well posed on the skilled workforce. So if you divide in two parts, one is the skill part. What do you need to be skilled? I think the current economic reality, including competitiveness challenge, but not only, has shown that, you know, skills is something that, of course, you acquire some basic skills when you are young, but then the crucial concept is the one of skills development or skills maintaining. I mean, skills is a little bit like, I don't know, an infrastructure. You construct a highway, but then you need to continue to maintain it. It's probably the biggest private infrastructure that a person can have, the skills, and lacking a regular maintenance, they just become obsolete. Not for nothing, the European Year of Skills, which you mentioned, and I'm thankful for that, which will be officially launched on the 9th of May, has a dynamic target, because the target of the European Year of Skills is a headline target, so to speak, for 2030, and in 2030 to have 78% of population in active employment, but also 60% able of the adult participating in training every year. This is a sort of a Copernican revolution, insisting regularly on the training. What can we do to support? You're generous to mention the work of DG reform. It is true that in DG reform we did work a lot in Greece, but not only in Greece on helping. I think this comes basically to the second important word you said, which is workforce. And the question of linking better the skills, the people, to the labor market. And how you can improve the matching or reduce the mismatching. Well, first of all, it's important to understand what the labor market asks for. And that, you said it, clearly the labor market in the next 10 or 15 years is very likely to ask for what Europe is going to, so green and digital transition, there is no doubt. But also the labor market will inevitably, because of demography and because of the way people move in an integrated European market, will of course look more and more at harnessing, cultivating talents and continuing. If we look at our projects, and now I'm not going to mention all of them, but if we look at our project, for example, in Spain, in Italy, on small and medium enterprises, in Spain, on putting together research organization with work and so on and on, most of these work are truly around the two components of making sure there is a continuous learning on the side of the workers, on the one hand, and on the other hand, making sure that we respond in a dynamic way to the labor market. I'm going to conclude here, but the crucial point to keep in mind is that in the next 15, 20 years, half of the job we know today will have disappeared, and we need to reskill in order to be able to go on what will really matter in 20 years. Thank you.
Listening to you, I just feel, and it's just a point also about the public dialogue here in Greece, that many times we are replying to the questions of the past.
Yeah.
Things are changing so fast, and even the politicians should be very well aware of the disappearing nature of works, of the new skills that definitely need to be addressed in order for us to incorporate within the curricula, of course, the curricula and the extracurricular activities, what the labor force will definitely need. And it's just about, not about getting a job, maintaining it, exactly, and feeling at ease with the context of what's happening around you. So we're thinking that the staff shortages in tourism we are facing very, very intensively. It's the number one discussion we have here in Greece. And of course, it's a global discussion. I was with the UNWTO, the United Nations World Tourism Organization deputies the previous week. We discussed about losing almost 66% of the workforce we had in tourism in the past 4 years. So what observations can you make, you know, concerning recruitment policies, you know, around Europe, also France, and, you know, what we can do about improving on these recruitment policies?
Well, it's a very good question. In France, you know, we have difficulties to recruit, and it's not new because there has been an increased tension in France since 2015, mm-hmm. And it's not going to improve, unfortunately, because as it has been said previously. There are more people going to retire and less people entering the market. And well, you mentioned the tourism sector, but even when you, if I take the example of the industrial sector, tensions were six times higher in 2021 than in 2015 in France. So. It's a tremendous problem in France, and I think that tourism, of course, is concerned, but several sectors like construction or industry, it's the same. Before answering your question, just trying to explain it. Of course, there is a good news in France is that unemployment is decreasing and the rate is at the moment quite good. It can be improved, of course, but it's 7.5%, so it's good news. But on the other side, mentalities are changing. People and young people want to work differently. They want remote working. They want a 4 day week if I again take the example of industrialization, of industries, the image is not so good for them because the industry has the image of a hard working condition. And also, as Marianne has said, there is a problem of upscaling people because our industries and tourism is the same, becoming more and more digitalized and more technological, and we have to change to have to change our mentality and our way of training and training people. So what can we do for that? Of course, we can try to put the training organisms and companies together, and to think about what kind of job, what kind of skills they need for the future, and in some sectors, trade unions work on it, putting together schools, putting together companies, and just thinking of what I need, what kind of skill I need now, and what kind of skill I will need in the future. And this effort to try to put in the same place different people from the ecosystem is very important, and not staying in different silo and thinking that we can find the solution alone. Some companies also have a solution by organizing their own training. And it's even more accurate when they're far away from big cities. It's difficult to recruit. It's difficult to recruit the right talent, the right competence. And some of them are organizing their own training center. And even in some region, we can see several companies sharing the same training center, in order to share the cost and also to share the solution. And of course, I think that also to find the right talent is of course a question of skills, but it's also a question of being able to attract them. And at BPI France, we try to also to sensibilize entrepreneurs on something that is for us very important, is the employer branding. And as I said, mentalities are changing. People want to find sense. I don't know if you say in English if it's the same word, sense, significance, exactly. In their job, and to have a strong employer branding is very important for people to be proud of being part of a company. Even I think that salaries, of course, is important, but for a lot of people, significance is even more important. Of course, if you have a decent salary. So it's a point, and companies and employers have to be very, very keen on this subject.
Just a couple of remarks on what you said. I definitely keep note also of the importance of the branding, of you know, of what is the identity, of what of course it is, the total you know perception of a company it has, and not just based and limited to salaries. When I was back an educator, we had a research, a very wide research among educators in public sectors, and we made very significant notes that it wasn't just the salaries that contributed to that, it was also the mindset and the collective action that was taken within the schools in order to feel proud of that. And also just a note of the significant decrease also of unemployment rates we also have here in Greece. It was 17.4 back in 2019. Now it is less than 11, at times, and we are focusing so much on the youth unemployment and, of course, the women. Access to jobs, you know, and definitely made sure that they're equipped with the skills in order to achieve them. Now, talking about, you know, the non-EU countries and probably trying to attract and retain these non-EU talent and skills and qualifications that are, of course, acquired outside the EU. And the very significant matter we're always faced with, the non-formally recognized ones. So how can EU attract and retain all these non-EU talents, of course, with the skills and qualifications that were acquired outside of it?
Thank you. Yes, I think when in last September in the State of the Union, it was launched, the idea of a year for skills was precisely to highlight these problems that we are talking. And in the response that the European Union is trying to activate, there is the activation of unemployed people, upskilling, reskilling, better guidance, also better mobility between member states, because very often that's one of the issues that is not working at its own all potential. And then the last one was to attract talent from third countries. And there, I think there are a number of issues to make it happen. And the talent pool and the talent partnerships are two initiatives, political initiatives in order to organize all these processes. The first problem is one of getting visas to come. I think this is still something that is not working enough, and very often this creates situations which talent people who could be covering some of these shortages, labor shortages, cannot really find the way to enter into the country and enter into a process of selection. So that's one problem. But the main problem is that of recognition of qualifications. So the fact that the qualifications that people have in their countries are recognized in the receiving country. And when it's not, this is only for some jobs and professions where really the certificate, the academic certificate is necessary. Normally the employers do not, for most of the jobs, they don't require a certificate as such. But there is also a problem of understanding what is behind a qualification of one person. And not always a formal qualification, very often is the skills and competences that someone has been accumulating in their life, very often through non-formal and informal learning processes. And there, one of the things that is necessary, which is not working fully yet in the single market, with the freedom of people to move and to find a job, is the fact that you understand the recognition, the qualification of others. There is a number of tools that have been developed by the European Union, from the European qualification frameworks, I can't remember now the name, but the Europass, and several classifications of competences and jobs, which allow really to better understand. And the fact that the qualifications are being modernized, not only in the European Union, but also in all the countries around the European Union. There's the ETF has been working a lot on supporting countries to develop this qualification reform and also develop qualification frameworks. And this is really the tools that allow the comparison between the qualifications. But this is very structural reforms. What you need in the short term is more systems to recognize and identify the qualifications that the skills that are behind the qualifications of someone, which then is the possibility to match with the jobs that are, particularly those that are not covered. So this is the work that we then, for that, the European Union also foresees a talent partnership, so that the human capital development systems in the countries that are sending this talented and skilled staff to the European Union also work in a way that these reforms are taking place in, and it can be understood also by the institutions, but most likely by the employers and the different public services in the European Union. That's the way of better matching the two sides of the profiles against candidates and vacancies. In this respect, I would also like to say that perhaps I'm anticipating the next question, but the sectors where more shortages are taking place, and you were mentioning now hospitality, no? Normally are not sectors which are very sophisticated in terms of skills. The sectors that have been identified with higher shortages are health, is hospitality, is IT, but IT also is a sector that is not a new sector. It's been a new technology for many years. And then construction. So these are very classical sectors to some extent. And what they are happening is that there is also there those are sectors that are getting greener. So they are changing their the way the skills that are required in this sector, and more digitalized. But at the same time, that this is what the bulk of the most of the jobs that are not being covered. There is. Very often when we talk about talent, we think about the high level of skills, which of course there is need there, and there we compete with the other countries globally. But at the same time, there is need for also low-skilled jobs. And we know very well all this issue of the development of the platform economy, the mini jobs in Germany. We see many jobs which really do not require a high level of skills, and very often the nationals do not want to undertake. And then at the same time, we see that in most of the sectors, there is this middle level of skills, which normally are not provided by high education, but by vocational education, which are really needed to these are the needs that are, you find these kind of jobs. And there, I have to say that all the systems of recognition of qualifications that exist inside the European Union, and even more when we are talking about third national countries, basically they are well developed for higher education and for recognized, for professions that are required certificate to work, but in vocational education and training, and in there the recognition between one country and another is far from being the working well. No? So these are the areas where we have to work in order to make this talent pool to work more efficiently.
Javier, let me also add to these sectors that you said that are of immediate, let's say, need for workforce from outside the EU is also, of course, agriculture. I don't know if you mentioned it, but here in Greece, it is of of great importance. It was one of the sectors that we work in with, you know, like also fishery and agriculture, and people are very much in direct, let's say, need all around Greece, also people from outside the EU. So Emily, you know, Javier was just talking about the green and digital transition, that we should also equip the people that come here also with this, you know, like harmonization of skills and better be prepared also for this transition. Now, how come these investments that are now taking place all around the EU directed at digital and of course green aspect, how can they also harness the full potential of the European workforce?
Thank you very much, Sophia. I think this is a very important question. Firstly, I think we have to note that the green and digital transition won't happen without the prerequisite skills. So I think finance isn't the big issue. There's a lot of money, I think, particularly on the EU side, and many governments are investing in this, but also the private sector. At the European Investment Bank, we survey firms and local governments to ask them what is the challenges that they seek with these investments. And actually, the results are pretty stark, and I would say really a call to action. So 85% of firms say that for a huge obstacle to investment is skills. And then when we talk to local governments, this becomes even more of a crisis. And they note this particular skills that they're lacking. So 7 out of 10 local governments tell us that economic and kind of the actual skills to do climate and environmental assessments are missing. So just coming up with a plan, never mind implementing it, is difficult because it's very hard to get this expertise. And then 6 out of 10 say that engineering and also digital skills are hugely missing. So without skills, we're not going to be able to do this. And then I think it's very important for us to think a little bit about what these skills are. And there's one really great source of information for this that I think we all probably use, maybe weekly, is LinkedIn. So LinkedIn covers 800 million people worldwide, and they've done some really interesting analysis on the development of green skills and green jobs. And of course, as we would expect, there's a huge growth in the demand for green jobs. I think the top ones are sustainability manager, wind turbine technicians, solar experts. But that's not really the big share of green jobs. I think that's interesting because a nice thing about LinkedIn is they note green skills, the type of skills you have in your job that will be applied to make what you do and what you produce more sustainable. And there it's actually fleet managers, data scientists, integrating these kind of skills to their jobs becomes very important. How do you manage the transport for a company? And so this is really bringing in these skills into like jobs that already exist. And I think that's very important to note because of course there will be some big training programs we'll need for very specific skills like battery operators or you know, inventors of new technologies. But actually what we need is on-the-job skills for existing jobs. And we know that for these types of this type of training, what you really do need is training on what you're doing every day. So this needs to be very related to what you do. But training of the worker is not enough. We also need very good management. And all of these transitions, be it AI, be it the green and digital transition, are going to really like require management. So you need to have managers who are putting this at the forefront in the public sector and also for firms. And we know from the evidence that if a firm doesn't have a manager who's directly responsible for climate and this transition, nothing tends to happen. So I think this is something that we're all going to have to think about in our jobs every day. This is not just focused on a few specialized areas.
Thank you very much. I think you also pointed at the beginning on the job training and the very crucial point, you know, in the role of the manager in order to be able to identify deficiencies and definitely cater for putting together such a program alongside, of course, the state agencies. And I would say also the municipality can play a significant role in that. You know, I would rather, you know, give the floor just for final remarks of 1 minute length. Could that be possible for every member of the panel? You definitely significant, you know, you signified the importance of skills, what is missing, what we should be targeting on, and I think the floor definitely belongs to you for the last remarks.
Okay, I would say three things. One, what you said for Greece, continuity of these skills. These skills don't stop at school. So in particular, the gap between school and the labor market needs to be filled. Two is the coherence of them with the labor market. So I think we need to make sure that there is more integration on the both on the demand and on the supply side between, for example, more career counseling at the level of the education system. That would help a lot. Or simple things like curriculum based on the outcome rather than what you have learned. And third and last is inclusiveness. You mentioned it. An education system which is inclusive is the best way against the demographic change.
Thank you very much. Thank you for keeping to the time limit, Isabel.
I just would like to come back to what you said about managers. Very, very important point. And at BPI France, we have created a university for managers. And each year we train hundreds of managers in accelerators. Where we put them together and we give them a coaching, a training, etc., just to have this to think together on the organization of their companies and on the future of their companies. And we have also creating a university and a digital university. It's bpifranceuniversite.com. It's free. You can go to see it, unfortunately, just in French, where you can find all the subjects a manager can have for his company. How improve my sales? What is digital marketing? How to improve my energetical transition, etc., etc. So we have also to train the managers. You're totally right.
Thank you, Isabel. Javier.
Three things, very fast. One is that I think in this transition towards a more green economy, there is on one side there will be people. All the forecasts are that there will not be a huge new jobs created, but the majority are jobs that change the skills mix they require. And there is where many jobs, from manager to the taxi driver, everybody will have to be greener in terms of energy, in terms of waste, in terms of all these things. And then here it's important, this sentence that is repeated very often of not leaving nobody behind, no? Because there will be people who will be moving sector or profession. And there is very easy that if their services are not there, some people, those who are perhaps they are more vulnerable, will be left behind. So I think that's one part. Second part, I think that I would like to highlight, I think it's very known, but it's important to repeat, when we are thinking of attracting talent from outside the European Union, it is important also that this is coupled with investment in those countries in terms of developing skills for their own development. Otherwise, there is a risk of brain drain, very important.
Emily.
Okay, well, finally, I'm going to come back to something that you mentioned, Sophia, and also Mario, which is that we need to make sure that we don't leave behind large segments of the population. So one thing is getting basic education right. We know that like 10% of 18 to 24-year-olds on average in Europe are leaving education early. Greece is actually doing very well on this.
Doing very well.
But this is an area, you know, which we can't afford with shrinking workforces. And you know, we know also that education levels are going to become even more important going forward. Secondly, we need to reach those parts of the economy that training and skills are not getting to. So small firms are very important. How do we bring them in? We know also that people without high levels of education don't tend to engage in lifelong learning. How can we make it relevant for them? And then lastly, we need to experiment. I mean, there is a huge digital transition. We can no longer deliver education just through the classroom. There's online learning, mentoring, all these management initiatives. We need to learn from them, experiment, test, and share knowledge.
Thank you so much. We made it. I'm thinking we made it in time. It's exciting times we live in, and I think we should definitely prepare our people, which is the greatest wealth, in order to be able to adapt to this. Thank you so much for this. Thank you, our lovely panel. Thank you for being here today.